Good morning, everybody. How y'all doing this beautiful day? Sounds like you're doing okay. Man, I'm excited to be with you this morning, and I'm excited again about what God is stirring in the hearts of our church family, and I'm excited about what He's going to stir in your heart this morning. Now, last week, we talked about how we are blessed and we are rich. Anybody here last week or watch the sermon? So, for those of you who weren't here, let me just recap for you real fast. God has richly blessed us. And what a privilege it is that we are in a situation that we are today. Almost any American is in the top 1% of the world. That's mind-boggling to us. I don't know your background or where you're at, but when I was growing up, it sure didn't feel like we were in the top 1%. I mean, come on, somebody, right? But when you look at the rest of the world, we are so blessed. Our poorest people are in that 1%. And if you make over the national average, you're in the top 0.1%. I mean, how cool is that? We are blessed and we are rich. And this whole series, we want to learn how we can be good at being rich, how we can take that which God has given us and invest into what matters most. Now, when it comes to money and just about anything else in life, I'm a pretty competitive person. Anybody in here play Settlers of Catan with me? You know what I'm talking about. I love to win. Like, it's a problem. I really, really like to win. And if the game has a prize, Lord have mercy, watch out. You want me on your team. Let me just say that. And I've always enjoyed that competition. And I remember at an early age, that competitiveness was already there. Me and my brother, one summer, we were staying with our grandparents down in Lakeland, Florida. And my grandpa was just awesome. He'd take us fishing and all this other stuff. And we saw this commercial on TV for what looked like the coolest place in the world. A place by the name of Chuck E. Cheese. And it just so happened they had one in Lakeland. So my grandpa took me and my brother to Chuck E. Cheese. And he got us some tokens. And we didn't want to play the racing games. We didn't want to play the shooter games. We wanted to play the games with tickets. Because that's how we can measure our success, right? How many tickets we got. And, you know, they're very smart. They put that prize cabinet right as you're coming in. So you see all these wonderful things that you can get if you have enough tickets, right? So we made sure we calculate in our little 8-year-old brains, you know, what is the best return on tokens to ticket ratios and all that. And we zeroed in on this one machine. And let me tell you, we just started putting the tokens in. And here comes the tickets. And here comes the tickets. And Grandpa caught on to this. And he must have spent $100 that night. And he got on the game too. And let me tell you what, he was good at winning tickets. $100. And we got the coolest prize ever. A cheap little disco ball. How cool was that? We could have got that for $5. But let me tell you what, we won it with the tickets, right? Great memories. And that desire for tickets is still in me. We took Valentina to a Chuck E. Cheese for her birthday this year. And, you know, being a loving father, you encourage them to go to the machines that they're more likely to get more tickets at, right? Like, have you ever been to the one there's that big dog mouth and you push the thing and the balls go in the mouth and you get tickets? Chase kills it at that, man. He is awesome. So the whole night, I'm like, Chase, let's go play this again. Let's play this again. Or the little froggy. You hit the thing and it puts a ball in the frog's mouth. I'm like, get out of the way, dude. You're not doing this. I got this. Why? Because I want the tickets. Like, by the time we're done, I want to make it rain up in there with the tickets. Look at me put these things in the machine. Come on, somebody. I'm about to get my kid that lollipop. Come on. Because this is how we measure success, right? Because we've got the tickets to prove that we're a winner. Now, how many of you guys know we like a point system? We like to see if we're winning or not, if we've got the most tickets. In real life, it's not the tickets from Chuck E. Cheese, is it? We look at our stack. We look at those greenbacks that we've got in our wallets. We look at that cash that we've got sitting in the bank. and we accumulate tickets. Because we like to win, right? We like to see this scorecard, and money is that way that we can look. It's how we judge, are we winning or losing in this life? It's a point system. Are we winning? And it's this scorecard that all of a sudden we get in this method and this lifestyle where we just gotta have more tickets. Gotta have more tickets, right? What can I do? Can I work overtime because I need more tickets? Can I get that other job because I need more tickets, right? Life becomes a game. And not just Chuck E. Cheese, but anything we can do to get more tickets. Because more tickets means more prizes, right? Just like at Chuck E. Cheese, our tickets, our money means we can buy stuff, right? See, if we have more tickets, we're happier, right? If we have more tickets, then I feel more secure because it's a barrier between me and these other things that could go wrong in our life. If I just have enough, I'll be happy. If I just have enough, I'm going to be safe and secure. If I have enough tickets, my kids are going to be happy, right? So we start going through life looking for more and more tickets. And we've all seen what the desire for more tickets can do to us sometimes. And when we start accumulating some, you notice how some people start walking just a little bit different when they got so many tickets? You guys are thinking of somebody. I heard those chuckles. You see the picture in your mind. Shame on you for being so judgmental. But they start talking a little differently, don't they? They start viewing themselves and others a little differently. It all of a sudden has an effect where all of a sudden we can become arrogant. But you know what the other side of that is? Whereas we think it's going to make us more secure, but it makes us more insecure because we're worried, how can we guard our tickets? We don't want that little snot-nosed three-year-old coming and grabbing my kids' tickets, do we? We start to guard those tickets because it has value, because we've placed so much value on it. You know, the reality is money, tickets, your stack, whatever you want to call it, is deceitful. It lies to us. And you guys, oh, don't tell me that, Pastor Chuck. I love my tickets. But you know what? If we allow that to have control over our hearts, if we allow that to have control over our lives, we're buying into a lie. Because this isn't the scorecard of our life. This isn't how we measure our life. In Matthew 13, Jesus tells us that the deceitfulness of wealth can choke out the word and make us unfruitful. The deceitfulness of wealth. You see, money demands that we give our life to it, that we're in a pursuit to acquire it. The deceitfulness of wealth. Rather than going after more of God, whether following his plan for our life, all of a sudden we start serving this because we want to see this pile grow and grow and grow. We start serving a false master. Here's the issue. I'm not about to get up here and preach about having stuff as bad. We looked at last week how God has blessed us. He provides for our enjoyment. But it's not about us, is it? Not about to make you feel guilty because you've got a stack. I hope that you're doing well. But here's the thing. Here's what I need you to start to wrestle with right now. Money promises something that only God can provide. Did you hear me? Money promises us something that only God himself can provide. It's a great deceiver. And now we're going to look at that this morning. You see, one of the things that money promises us is happiness. How many of you know spending a little bit of cash can make you happy for a little bit? That new house, that's all nice, isn't it? You get that new house feel, your brand new granite, all that. It's good. It makes us happy for a little while. That new car, those newer, bigger, better things that we all enjoy, right? How about that dream motorcycle? Or in my case, that dream yacht that you just got to have, right? Lord help me, right? Or that Michael Kors purse. Sorry, ladies. I had to go there. I'm going to bust on the men. I got to bust on you guys, too. That dream vacation. All of that. And it makes us happy for what? A short while. It's not a joy that's everlasting. It's not a joy that sustains us. But it gives us a momentary boost. And the other thing that money promises us is security. We think if we just have enough of it, we're going to be okay. We don't have to worry about anything. Fire me if you want. I've got enough in the bank. Or you know what? If I get sick, that's okay. I got enough money to afford whatever doctor's treatment I want. If I have enough money, my kids don't have to worry about anything. They're going to be happy. I'm off the hook. I'll just pay somebody to make them happy. It gives us this sense of security. You see, money is always telling us that it is our source of happiness. It's telling us that it is our source of security. How easy it is, though, to believe that, isn't it? How easy it is to start looking at it that way. See, Paul, who wrote much of the New Testament, he had a lot to say about money. Jesus has a lot to say about money, too. And this is something that we see the New Testament talking about a lot. And in one particular letter that Paul writes to Timothy, one of his proteges, he talks to Timothy about how to help the rich people in your church handle this blessing that they have. You see, Paul would plant these churches in all these port towns around the Mediterranean. And in port towns, you have a lot of centers of wealth. And in these centers of great wealth and affluence, Paul, Timothy, and his whole crew were able to reach not just the poor people, but they were able to reach the rich people. So Paul writes this letter to Timothy and said, hey, you've got rich people in your church. Great. Now, let's help them to understand how to manage this which God has given and how to relate with money. And you've got this new worldview in your faith in Jesus. So in 1 Timothy 6:17, let's look at the first part of what Paul tells us right here. He says, command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope, this is key right here, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Now, how cool is that? Paul doesn't say, no, it's wrong that you have money. He says, do not put your hope in that money. Don't put your hope in your wealth. Don't put your hope in your stack. Don't put your hope in your tickets. But put your hope, put your faith in God. Don't let yourself become arrogant. Don't let yourself think of yourself because you've got this false scorecard you're looking at. Put your hope in God because it's Him who provides. Guys, Paul addresses that deceitfulness head on right here. And remember something. As we laid out last week, we're rich. We are rich and we are blessed. This is advice for us right here, right now, today. See, we don't have a reason to be arrogant if we know it's God who's provided. We don't have a reason to think too much of our stack because it's God who has provided it to us. He provides for our enjoyment. He provides for our needs. He is our source. You see, if we start looking to money as the source, we miss it. We miss it. Money's not our source. God is. And we've got to be careful to guard our hearts against this lie that our stack wants to tell us. And let me tell you, it does a good job of providing that illusion of happiness and security, doesn't it? It does a really good job of providing that illusion. But you know, it doesn't last. That new house that you got, how long does it take before there is a leaky pipe? How long does it take until that hailstorm comes and takes off your roof? That thing which brought you happiness can bring you a lot of distress as well, can't it? That motorcycle that you just loved for all 1,000 miles and now is constantly in the shop. Ouch, right? Or those clothes that brought you so much happiness that now depress you because you can't fit into it anymore. Come on. It may bring us a little bit of happiness, but it's like a drug. Or that security. How many of you guys know that money doesn't provide us security? It may feel nice, but what happens when you get that prognosis from the doctor and it doesn't look good and you realize that this can't heal you? And only God can heal. What happens when you find out your kid is hooked on drugs? What's this going to do about that? Nothing. Because this promises us something. This promises something that only who? God can provide. This isn't where our faith is in. It's in Jesus. Amen? So the problem is, if we keep looking at this and we don't deal with this deceit in our lives, we start serving this. Jesus talks about that in Matthew 6:24. He says, "No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." You see, the world wants us to serve this. It doesn't want us to serve God. It doesn't want us to serve God. This wants us to serve it. But see, that's why we've got to look to God with our whole hearts, with our whole minds, with all of our strength, all of our soul. Because you see, this should serve us as we serve God. We shouldn't serve this and serve God on the side as a hobby. Our money needs to serve us as we serve God, not the other way around. This is a tool, this is a blessing, but it can become a curse if it becomes our master. Now, here's the thing. I think you guys all agree with me by now that this can be deceiving. But how do you know if you're under its influence? How do you know if it's what's controlling what's going on in your heart? How do you know if that's what's influencing your heart and your mind? It's a tricky little bugger. It's tricky. So let's look at some stuff real fast. You guys with me? All right. You may be under the influence of money if the first one, you never have enough. You see, if you love and trust money, if that's what's up, if that's your God that you're serving, you see, you just don't have enough of it. You're never content with where you're at. You see, in my experience, this is crazy. It defies all logic. But the poorest people I've met in the world, whether that was in Honduras or East Europe or whatever, they're some of the most content, happy people I've ever met. But yet some of the most discontented people are some of the wealthiest people I know. Not always, but it's striking to me how often that is. See, you're under the influence of money. If I ask you how much is enough, and your answer is always more. If that's your answer, if that's your desire, there's a good chance that that's what's calling the shots in your hearts and lives. In Ecclesiastes 5:10, it says, "Whoever loves money never has enough." Never has enough. Whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with their income. That hits it right on the head. You see, if you don't have contentment, you will never be content with more, because you've got to have more. Maybe you're making $20,000 right now and you're scraping to get by. But if you're not content, when you get to $40,000, you're not going to be content then either. Maybe you're going to go up to $100,000. If you're not content now, you're not going to be content then. Maybe you get $100 million. How much is enough? Not enough. It's not enough. Because if we're under the influence of money, that's our happiness and that's our security. And because it can't provide what it promises, it's never, never enough. We've got to stop looking at this as our source, because we can never have enough of this. Don't get me wrong, okay? I think you need to manage your money wisely, and you should have emergency funds and retirement and all that in place. But there's a difference between managing wisely and putting faith and trust here. The faith and trust is here. It's never, ever enough. Now let's move on. You might be under the control, you might be under the influence of money if it's hard to give big. And this is like, ooh, I'm going to start getting uncomfortable here. Come on. Ooh, I'm going to walk out and use the restroom about right now. Let me tell you what. So there's some people in here. You guys are just awesome. The way you guys gave last week, that tells me there's some people in here that's not under the influence of money. And I love it how you're willing to bless people like that. You see, one day Jesus was hanging out at the temple. You see this in the Gospels. And he was watching how the people would come and bring their offering. See, they didn't pass the plates real discreetly like we do here. They had these big jugs up at the very front of the temple. So if you were going to bring your offering, you grabbed it and you strutted all the way to the front. And you dumped it in. And Jesus talks about how these wealthy people and all their robes, I mean, they did their prints. They had that walk. And they got their bags and they just dumped it out. So every coin made that sound. They're like, come on. Come on. Look at me. Look at me. Look at me. I'm giving. But then there was this woman, this widow. She had two coins. She made her way up to the front. And she dropped her two coins in there. And that was all she had. That was all that she had. Her whole life savings, every bit of her own, she dropped in there. Jesus said, you know, it's not that wealthy guy who just dropped in all that stack right there, but this woman who gave everything. She wasn't under the control of money. The others were. They wanted everybody to see how much they were given because that was their scorecard. It wasn't the humility. It wasn't what God was trying to do in their hearts and lives. It was the money. But this woman gave everything that she had. That's tough. Let me tell you what. I've wrestled with this big time, personally. When I was a youth pastor, I was started off at 16 years old doing that. And one of the students in my youth group was my little brother. Talk about kind of weird, right? Something real big that we did back then was we supported Speed the Light, which your teenagers here support as well. Speed the Light's a fund to help missionaries have the equipment that they need to reach people. And at the beginning of that year, we'd all made a commitment and we've done fundraising because we want to help support this ministry. And it was Christmas time this year. And like always, we were opening our gifts and our grandparents always gave us cash money because, you know, once you get out of elementary school, what are they going to buy you? You just want cash, right? That's what they did. And I remember our whole family was sitting around the tree. Everybody just opened their stuff. My brother David grabbed every single dollar that he got for Christmas. He brought it up to me and he's like, hey, this will cover the rest of my commitment for Speed the Light. I didn't like that. Let me tell you what, that put me in some turmoil. I mean, just imagine if your kid did that. You feel that like, oh, right? Let me tell you what, my brother's faith wasn't in his money. His happiness wasn't wrapped up that he got some Christmas money. His joy, his strength, his reward was in Jesus. Let me tell you what, God has richly blessed him because God knows that if he gets it to him, he can get it through him. It's hard to give big. It's hard to give like that when we're under the control of our money. And the more we have, the harder it is to give. So much harder. We tend to think, you know what? When I have all my debts paid off, that's when I'm going to start giving. Or, you know, when I get that raise I've been waiting on, that's when I'm going to start giving. Or when I have this much money in savings, that's when I'm going to be generous. Guys, there's a world that's hurting that needs the love of Jesus. Some of what you have, God's got it to you because he wants to get it through you. And if you can't be generous now, you'll never be generous. You'll never be generous. If that woman can go up to the front of the temple and give everything she had, but yet we have everything that we need, and we can't give big now, we never will. God wants to use that to break the control of money in our hearts and in our life. Paul shares a similar story in 2 Corinthians, talking about the Macedonian churches. He said, in the midst of a very severe trial, they're overflowing. This is a key word here. Their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able and even beyond their ability, entirely on their own. These people didn't have much. Extreme poverty, but out of so much joy, they gave beyond their means. Guys, we have a lot. What a joy it is to be able to give. What a joy it is to be part of God's plan in this world, to use that which he's richly blessed us with to better this world, to be his hands, to be his feet in this world. When we choose to give, you know, we find life. When we hoard it to ourselves, we find death. God wants to flow through us. God wants to use us, but it takes us finding that joy, that life, when we submit our hearts, we submit our life, we submit our wealth to Jesus. Amen? All right, the last point that we're going to look at. You may be under the control. You may be under the influence of money, if there's money in the bank, but no peace in your heart. Let that one sink in for a little bit. Maybe under the influence of money. There's money in the bank, but no peace in your heart. Or maybe if there's toys in the garage, but no peace in your heart. There's shoes in the closet, but no peace in your heart. You have all this stuff, but no fulfillment and no joy. Proverbs 15:16 says, better a little with the fear of the Lord than great wealth with turmoil. How many of you guys know that's right? Better a little with the fear of the Lord than great wealth with turmoil. I'd rather have a lot more of the peace of God in my life than turmoil. Amen? I would rather have more of what He has for me than a paper stack that I can withdraw from the bank. You know, it's not that riches are bad. It's who has your heart. Money wants to deceive us. Money wants to steal our hearts away from God. It's about understanding whose we are. We don't serve this. We serve Him. And that makes all the difference. See, rich people have rich people problems, right? That 4G just isn't fast enough. Why do we let that steal our peace? Why do we let that steal our joy? That's rich people problems that we don't have. But if we put our faith and our hope in God, it doesn't matter how many rich people problems we have, amen? It's not going to steal my joy. It's not going to steal my peace because He's my provider. Not Sprint's lousy 4G. Come on. Some of you guys are there with me. I hear, I feel you. You know, I've heard a lot of financial advisors talk about how some of the richest people in this world live under such a burden. Many financial advisors said they never want to be the ultra rich because it's too crushing of a burden. Even a few million dollars can provide so much turmoil and such a crushing burden that it robs of peace. Now, some of you guys are thinking, well, I'll throw a couple of those million my way and let me find out. If you're thinking that, that's because this has a grip on you. Trick statement. You know, we need to be good at being rich. God wants us to enjoy what He's blessed us with. But we need to be good at being rich because we need God's peace, His love in our life. Because, guys, it's not about us. You know, wealth can distract us from the biggest priorities, our kids, our families, our health, because we're serving money. But if we're serving God, if we're serving Him first and our money serves us as we serve God, we can enjoy what we have and make such a huge difference in this world. You guys feel me? You know what I'm saying? Some of us make more money than our parents did. Some of us right now make more money than we ever thought that we'd be able to make in our lives. But yet we're still strapped. We were never meant to consume everything that we have. There's people that make half the money you make, that they're making it and they're happy. We're not meant to be consumers. We're meant to be generous. We're meant to be overflowing in that joy of generosity. Just like the Macedonian church, out of great joy, even though in the poverty they gave, they experienced such a rich blessing from God. I want that peace of God in my life because I want Him to have my heart. I don't want this to have my heart. Amen? Come on now. We were never meant to be consumers. We were meant to be life givers. We were meant to be generous and intentionally generous. You know, maybe one of these indicators kind of made you tense up a little bit. And you're wondering, okay, maybe it does have a little bit of hold. What do I need to do? Let's talk about that for a second. Paul gives some instructions to Timothy in the next two verses from what we first looked at. Let's check this out real fast. In 1 Timothy 6, 18 and 19, Paul instructs Timothy, command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. In this way, they will lay up treasures for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. In its essence, money tries to promise us life. It tries to promise us life. But Paul says, when we learn to be generous, when we learn to do good, to serve and to give, we experience the life that is truly life. And that comes from one place. One place. And that's from Christ Jesus. We're blessed and we're given so much. I'm so honored that God has blessed me the way he has blessed me. We all know the saying, to whom much is given, much is required. I want to challenge you this morning to take hold of this opportunity that we have as the body of Christ to serve the Lord in good deeds, to serve the Lord in generosity. What's your priorities in life? Is it to love people? Is it to love God? Or is it to serve tickets? Is it to serve cash? Ask God to take control of your mind, of your heart. Invest in good works and rich generosity. We don't have to give into this lie, do we? We don't have to serve this. You see, our money can serve us as we serve God. We've got to have the right priorities. We've got to have the right stuff in order. It's not the answer to our problems. Jesus is the solution. Not our stack, not our stocks, none of that. It's Jesus that's the solution. Do not trust in your own riches, but in him who richly provides. Can we say that together?
You're alive.
Do not trust in your own riches, but in him who richly provides. See, Jesus wants to transform your life. He wants to transform your heart. See, if we don't submit to that transforming power, what Jesus wants to do, our money can destroy us. But when we submit our hearts to Jesus, we're transformed into more and more of his perfect image. We can experience that peace and that joy when we serve him with our whole mind, our whole body, our whole soul, and our whole heart. Let's not hold too tightly to the things of this world, but let's look at eternity. There's people that need to know about Jesus. We need to make sure our hearts is in alignment with that. We weren't created to serve our wealth. We're created to serve Jesus. Let's get it in the right order. God richly provides for us. He richly provides for our enjoyment and for our needs. He is our provider, and we can have hope and peace in that. I think it's cool to have stuff, but let's make sure our stuff doesn't have us. Don't trust in your own riches this morning, guys. Don't trust in your own riches, ladies. But in him who richly provides. Would you guys stand with me? I want to challenge you. Serve big. Give big. Let your main priorities be your main priorities. Don't allow this to influence your heart. Don't allow this to influence your mind. But be transformed. Would you bow your heads with me? Maybe you're in here this morning and you haven't experienced that life that Jesus wants to give yet. You see, the first step that all of us need to make sure that money isn't what controls us is a relationship with Jesus. We know that Jesus came to this world, died, and rose again so that we can be free of the grips of sin in our lives. We can be free from the grips of money and addiction and pain because Jesus already paid the price. That's step one, to follow him and experience that freedom that he wants to give you. If that's you this morning and you haven't taken that step to follow him yet, I want to pray and agree with you this morning that you can step into a relationship with him. He's here right now and he wants to meet you. If that's you, would you just slip up your hand? I'm not going to make you do anything weird or funny. I just want to pray and believe with you this morning. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone waiting to take that step? Thank you. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your life. Father, we stand in agreement. For those who are ready to walk into a relationship with you, we ask that you would just come into their life right now. God, we invite you in.
Symbols.
We confess that we've done a lot of bad stuff, God, that we've sinned against you. But God, we want to experience your life and your transforming power in us. God, would you come in, forgive us, and help us to follow you. Help us to experience a life that you've prepared for us. In Jesus' name. And Father, right now, I just pray over our church family. God, I thank you for what you're doing in their hearts and lives. And God, right now, we just speak against the control that money wants to have over our life. We speak against that influence that it wants to have over our hearts. God, we submit our hearts. We submit our lives fully unto you. God, help us to serve you. God, help us to have things in the right order, that our money serves us as we serve you. God, help us to be rich in good deeds. Help us to be rich in generosity. Use us, God. Use us to be your hands, your feet. God, your words of life in this world. Father, we thank you so much that you have richly provided in us. And God, turn our hearts and our lives to you. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Guys, join us as we worship for another song, and we'll be right back.
You are who you say you are. You'll do what you say you'll do. You'll be who you've always been to us, Jesus. And our hope is in you alone. Our strength in your mighty name. Our peace in the darkest day remains, Jesus.
Sing it out.
This we know, we will see the enemy run. This we know, we will see the victory come. We hold on to every promise you ever made. Jesus, you are unfailing. Our guide through the wilderness, our joy in the heaviness, our way when it seems there is no way, Jesus.
Lift our voices to him this morning.
'Cause this we know, we will see the enemy run. This we know, we will see the victory come. We hold on to every promise you.
We can trust you, Lord.
And we trust you. Yes, we trust you. 'Cause your ways are higher than our own. We trust you. Yes, we trust you. Your ways are higher than our own. We trust you in all things. We trust you.